So this is again the Power Apps Portal Administration and final and the part 5 of the Portal Deep Dive series. So again, who is joined newly, I know everyone has attended one or the other of my sessions. So again, I'm working with Redspire Glasgow, and I have previously worked in India and Belgium with Accenture of NARD, Microsoft India and Business and Decisions in Belgium. I have overall 6+ years of experience in business applications, and I'm a techno-function consultant. That's about me. So let's go and see the agenda for today. We are gonna see how we can see the admin center for the Power Apps portal, and what all things we can get the information from, and what are the places we can actually jump to the Power Apps portal admin center. Then we'll be seeing the migrate portal configuration. If you have developed the portal configuration and one environment, how to take it to the another one, because this is recent, like it used to be a challenge, but not nowadays, because we have got the portal record mover in XRM toolbox. So using that, we'll be seeing a demo, and then we'll be seeing a couple other points from the admin center perspective, like how to download a public key for the portal. These are just one clicks away, but yeah, need to have information around that, how each of the portal action actually works, how to see the portal error logs, how to reset a portal, how to restart a portal, how to change the base URL for a portal, if you would like to upgrade the portal, how to do that, and portal lifecycle, and just about little about the cookies, how the portal holds them. And then we'll be seeing little demos, but not for everything, because it's not possible in case like resetting the portal takes a lot of time. So we'll be seeing the steps how to do that, but some of the portal actions we can't actually do in the demo today. And then in the end, we'll be having a Q&A session. So first one is about, again, how to go to the Power Apps portal admin center. So what it does basically, as an admin, definitely whatever we are seeing today requires the admin rights, or as a global admin, a user should be to perform any of these. So we need to consider, like reconsider, that our user is having the right privileges in order to do any portal action as an admin. So allows you to do certain actions. We are going to see what are those, and how to find the portal ID, application ID and things, because that is required when you actually integrate the portal, let's say with Cafe Expert Chat or chatting perspective, you need to have the ID of the application. So we'll be seeing just now the portal admin center and other information about that. And then we'll also see a little demo on Power Apps portal admin, basically from the admin center as well of the Power Platform. So let me just jump to the directly through Dynamics and see that. So how to go there? If you go to the Power Apps, click on apps, and you will definitely see the portal management tab, because we have provisioned the portal. And then we will see our portal here, right? So how to go to the admin center for the portal, as if you click on three dots, you go to the settings here, and you see three things: authentication setting, and then administration, and the site setting. As we are gonna see the administration part, so if you click on that, we go to the admin part of the Power Apps portal here. So when we see this, basically we have a lot of information from the admin perspective here. Definitely, if we see that we have this name, we can modify this name as well, and this base URL as well if we require. And then we have portal audience we see as customer, and it's a starter portal. Earlier, when we used to have a trial with different model driven apps, let's say sales, service, marketing, we used to have partner portal, customer self-service portal, other lot of options, but this is just Power Apps, not any Dynamics app. So we just have a starter portal. I would say it's like a custom portal, which has nothing. It just, we need to, you know, from the scratch, we need to customize it. And the portal state on, what does that mean if you make it off? When you actually visit the portal, it says that site is not working or something like that, or services unavailable. And if you, sometimes when we clear the cache, our changes are not reflecting, we need to restart the portal. So in that case, we just mark it as off and then update it, and then click on again and update it. In that case, a portal gets restarted and all the cache, cookies, whatever gets deleted from the browser, and it works well. And apart from that, we have this option, enable portal for early upgrade. This is to basically get all the updates automatically installed. So we have this option, we can check that. And this is how the portal admin center looks like. And then we have the portal actions here. So we have different portal actions. We'll be seeing each of them by the slides, and then we'll be coming here and just performing some actions here. And this option basically tells your this portal is connected to which Dynamics instance. So let's say this is connected to this one. If your tenant has multiple Dynamics environments, definitely we can change that environment here, or you can just to see the information as an admin, this is the place where you can look for. And this is for the SharePoint integration, which I'm not covering here. And this is for the Power BI integration. So if you would like to embed Power BI report or dashboard, you need to come here and first enable the Power BI integration. Just for the visualization, this is enough. But for the embedded service, we need to enable this option as well. It's just, again, one click away. Then portal checker, if there are like if you're deploying to any other environment and you would like to check whether there are any errors in the backend which your portal is facing, you can just run this, and based on the categories, it's gonna show all the errors here. Portal authentication key, it's just for your portal app key basically, and this one we can also see from the Azure, because your portal is nothing but the app which is basically be placed in the Azure app registration as well. And this is, I'm not too sure, setup IP address restriction. This is might be to not allow basically, or allow just to on the particular IP addresses. So this is how your portal admin look, but you definitely have another place where you can just go to the portal admin. So we have just gone from the Power Apps, make.powerapps.com. Now the another interface from where we can also go to the Power Admin Center as your admin.powerplatform.microsoft.com. So here, if you see, if you click on the resources, you have portals here. So multiple portals, you can just say that manage, and it takes you to the same admin center window, which we were seeing right from the portal apps. And apart from this, you can also go to the environments, and then from the environments also, you can visit to the portals. If you go to the environments, I have two environments, one is default one. And from here, you can also see portal somewhere, I think. Yes, so you see the portals here, and then you can visit your portal directly from here. It does the same thing. So three places you can visit the portal admin center. So next one, when we know that how to go to the Power Apps, you know, admin center for the portal, and what all things we can do. So the first one we are going to see is the interesting one, because till now we were learning what is portal, how to configure, how to customize, how to basically make your website ready. Now your website is ready and we need to deploy it to another environment. How to do that? The best way we are going to see today. So basically what it does is there are like portal configuration. When we need to migrate, it's just about, you know, migrating the records from one environment to another. There is nothing like entity schema or things that we are going to migrate. What it migrates, it's just the records for some entities which are part of the portal management app. Now, as we know that part of Dynamics, we have a lot of option to export the data and import the data, right? So we can export through Excel, CSV and import, or the configuration migration tool. But there are a lot of issues that we face when we actually, you know, migrate portal data using those options. So in the XRM toolbox, there is a tool called Portal Record Mover. That is like you just connect it, select which entities records you would like to move, and then just export and import the data. So we'll be seeing the demo for that, how it works. But portal configuration, if we want to migrate from one environment to another, nothing but just, you know, moving the data from here and there. And the best link that I have found from the Nick Dolman, it's this one on the record mover. If you would like to go back and see, but definitely we are going to also see the demo on that. So we will be having demo on that just now. So I have two portals. One is this one where I have done little customization. So if you see that in this particular portal, I just have this logo here, just change the little content here and edit this. And then I have added one web link set, under which I have three web pages. I don't have much content on that. It's just to know that this environment has little changes, and then we are going to deploy it to another environment and see how they actually move. So if I click on one test web page, it just nothing, just shows some paragraphs. I'm like, okay, web page is successful and it's working fine. So we have already seen how to create a web page, page template and web template. This is how the web links set and web links visible here. And then we have logo and everything, right? And let's just check the target instance, which has nothing. It's just a blank trial one. I have just created 15 minutes ago. So we don't have anything here, right? So let's understand how to basically, you know, move the records. So I have made some notes here as per my, you know, experience. What we exactly do, we connect to the tool that we are gonna do just now, the load item. What does it mean is it just loads the entities, mostly which are related to the portal. And then we have the opportunity to select some entities, and we need to, because some entities actually cause some problems. For example, if we have forum notification, page notification, invitation, notes, all these we need to disable. Exceptional is the notes. Even though we disable it, we need to make sure that we have web file entity selected, because for portal, all the notes and activity, all the notes basically and the files are added as part of web file. So if we deselect the out of the box notes entity and we select this, all the portal related web file or the notes will be moved. Okay, and then we choose our website for which we are going to actually do the migration. And then after retrieval of the data, we again have one facility to deselect some particular records that we don't want to move. And then we export that file, that data comes in the XML file. And then finally, we just import the same file that we exported and select the correct environment. And then basically it gives some pop-ups to disable the plugin. And we just go for it because it helps in not creating duplicate records, because there are some portal plugins which just create some, you know, content web pages if you have multiple languages and things. So we try to avoid running the plugin while moving the data, and then automatically it just reactivate the plugins once your data is moved. So let's jump and see how it exactly works. So I am into the XRM toolbox, and here if you just go to the tool and type that portal record mover, I have also done a deployment a lot of time using configuration migration tool, but again, it creates some issues sometimes. It creates a duplicate records even though you take the ID in account, but this one I found it really good. It just, you know, selecting, exporting, importing directly, no need to worry about anything. So it says that you want to connect to organization first. Yes, definitely. I would like to connect to this org, which has my some customization in place. So once my org is connected, as we have seen that this tool, we are gonna load items. So it is just gonna load some entities, and some entities we are gonna deselect because as per the experience, they create issues like notes and notification things. So if we say select all and then deselect couple of entities, let's say, is there any notification? We have page notification, invitation, and then we are gonna also deselect notes if it is there. If not, then we are good. Is there forum notification? No, we don't have any other entity that we would like to. As per my notes, if we just have a quick look, page notification, forum notification, invitation, and notes. Yes, we don't have any other entities apart from that. So we say retrieve records. While retrieving, it's just gonna retrieve records from this particular website. I just did one wrong thing here. We're gonna correct after this. So definitely I need to select my website from which I'm gonna retrieve the records. So I have just one website as a starter portal, and I say just get only active records, because if I don't select this option, it's gonna also, you know, retrieve the records which are not active. So if I say retrieve records here, yes, so my records are retrieved, and you see that all these entities are displayed here and says how many records are this, let's say content snippet, 92 records. We do have ability to deselect particular record not to be exported. Just now what we have done, just retrieved. We didn't actually export the records. So we have just retrieved the records based on the entity selection and some conditions that we have given, like get only active records from this website. Now let's say we want all the records, we don't want to remove any of these records, we say export records. And we found some web files with more than one annotation, please ensure only Aisha want to continue. Let's say yes. And let me just save here on the portal records, and I'm just replacing my existing XML file, my records are exported. Now the task is my records are there in the XML file, and now I'm gonna import those. So I'm not gonna import in the same environment, so I need to connect to the different environment, and I just open the same tool again. And then I think it's connected to the same one, so I need to connect to the another target one, right? So I go to the SDK login and then open SDK login credentials, Office 365. The credential for my target instance is this. So I'm just gonna give the URL and say login. Okay, so this one is connected to the correct environment, which is, I think it's still connected to the old one, so I need to connect to this one. We can see the URL of the environment here, and definitely let me just select maybe all tabs, that's fine. Yes, it's connected to the right environment. Let me just quickly cross-check whether my environment is correct or not. Yes, it's just the VPC part 5 target. Okay, so now I will try to import the records. I browse. I'm just gonna select the correct file. So it's just now I have exported 2010-2020. I'm just gonna select this and open and then say import. Here again, we got the pop-up for disabling the plugin and web file cleaning. We'll always go with yes to in order to avoid the duplicate of the records. So here when the progress is gonna be in place, we will see it will say reactivating the plugin. It says now it retrieved the metadata, now gonna disable the plugin, and slowly it will do the lookup referencing as well. When we import actually where the Excel or CSV, we need to take that also into the account. So let it load and then we'll see the deployment is done. Sometimes we do get the errors. In that case, we need to it will give us the log file and we have the access to the log file. We can just read. Sometimes there can be issues, some entities are missing in our target instance if someone has deleted for the entity which the record we are trying to import for. So error definitely can come, but generally this tool is really good. I just loved it for deployment purpose. So it's covering the count of the success records and errors as well here. And if you see the pop-up, one phase without lookup being populated, another one is with lookup. So referencing and all thing it takes into the account by itself. We can also actually deselect all of the entities. Let's say we just created two web templates, two page templates and some web link sets. We can just select those records and move. It will be a little faster rather than, you know, moving all the records if not required in that case. So once all the records are done, it will enable the plugin again and add the file restriction, those two things which it actually disabled while processing the record. So it says import successful or import complete. Let me just close this window, let it be odd. Here we see the log file as well. If there are any errors, we go to the log file and access what is the actual error. Now let's go to the target instance and see how the deployment has happened. That was so quick. And portal deployment is like that because we just have to move the records, nothing else. So if we just have quick validation, are there some web templates which are created like the custom ones, because this was just a newly fresh target instance. So if I just say I had few web templates, let's say test, do we have them? Yes, so those are actually in place. So my deployment looks like successful, but let's check. So you see your target instance, your website looks like the source one. With just few clicks away, it didn't even take much efforts. It just export, import, and that's all. And this tool is really helpful. So this is how we can, you know, migrate portal configuration records. And let's jump to the slides again. So we have done the configuration part, export and import. Now jump to the portal actions. As an administration, we have multiple portal actions available. First is restart portal. We have seen it just again, just switching on and off the portal. But if you don't want to do on and off, like, you know, 2-3 clicks, there is a portal action directly to restart the portal. So we can do that. And then we have update Dynamics 365 URL. In case if we would like to connect our portal to the different environment, if there are different environments available for the same tenant, install portal service automation extension. As we have seen, when we were provisioning the portal for the partner one, when we had the Dynamics app, in that case, if you're going for the partner portal with the extension for PSA or the field service, we can install these extensions as well if you have the proper licensing. Get public key. So again, if you would like to integrate your portal with any, for example, the CafeX or any chatbot, we would need the portal key, public key, so that a portal can access or a chatbot can be connected with the portal. So we need to get the public key. We'll be seeing that, how to get that. Get latest metadata translation. It's again about, let's say your portal is enabled for English today, and then later on you want to enable it for multiple languages. Your web page will have number of content pages depending on the number of languages you have for the portal. So initially, when you select the number of languages, let's say for one web page, if your portal is enabled for two languages, there will be two content web pages associated with the one web page, which is the information and the main web page. Let's say later on you enable the language, at that moment you won't have, you know, the web page, the content web page in that particular language. So to get that translation and things, we need to click on this particular portal action to get the proper metadata for that. Similarly with the content snippets. And then disable custom error or the enable custom error. It's just about whenever there is any server side error you would like to display on the screen, we need to enable this option or we need to disable this option. And then we have reset the portal. Reset the portal is about deleting all the customization which you did. Your portal will be reset back to the how it was when you actually, you know, installed or provisioned it. Change the base URL. We can just do that again for the portal. If your customer wants to know it, it's something like VPG part 5, we wanted part 6. We can update that URL anytime. Enable maintenance mode. So if you're in production or deployment is going on, you can enable this mode to make sure that customer can read the proper information that your service is down. The way we, you know, access some of the bank site basically for transaction in the night and say service is down. So similarly, we can enable for our portal this maintenance mode. Again, just a little detail. So download the public key of the portal. Now what we are going to focus in the rest of the part is, if I just go to the admin center and go to the portal action, we will be seeing the multiple portal actions. So get the public key. Either you can click on this and you can just get the key. So this key, let's say when you are integrating a portal with the third party service, if they ask for the public key so that they can integrate, basically this is going to help in connecting. So you need to provide this. There is another way to get the public key. You just need to type in this after your portal link. So if you type this, you'll be getting a public key. So there are two ways you can just get the public key for the portal. It's just not found. How come? So let me just say that services and public key. It should just give you the public key here. So this is how, again, administration is not like we need to learn something. It's just about knowing the things and performing the right action when needed. So this is how we can get that. Again, steps are given, and then second way, just typing this, which we have done. So the best example is for the chatbot using the CafeX, because a lot of the customers has done this for the chat perspective. And again, import metadata translation, as I said, this one is very important when you have multiple languages enabled for your portal, because let's say you have lots of content snippets in English and later on, not at the time of provisioning, you enable a language. Now you have a lot of content which is redirecting from the content snippet. Definitely you need a content snippet in different language as well. Creating each record manually is gonna take a lot of time. So rather use this facility and just click, and it's just gonna create all the web pages in that language. Again, all the extra content snippets, but the value you need to provide in the same language. So how it looks, again, if we go here into the admin center, portal actions, and we have get latest metadata translation. Again, if you just click on update, it's gonna create by the, I think there is some plugin in the backend which just helps. So I'm not gonna do it now because it might you know, just take some time. So I'm not just, it's just again one click away. So this one is, again, I have tried in my live project and it was really helpful when we had lot of web pages and data. Next one is portal error logs. So we'll be seeing that we have multiple ways that we can get error logs for your portal. So there is one thing that I think everyone has seen, not in Power Apps portal, but normal website, that we see one screen called YSOD, that is yellow screen of death, and how that looks is like that, like sometimes when his application is failure or not working. So if to enable this particular option to see the data error for the developer, this screen is definitely helpful for the developer who is developing the portal. To see this particular error, we need to disable the custom errors on the portal. And how to disable it? Just again, if I go here, you have option disable custom errors. And if you click on that, you need to just click on disable. And similarly, if you disable this, in place of that, it comes the enable custom error. So we can just do that. And how to display a custom error message on the when you get the server side error? For that, there is a content snippet, a particular content snippet that we need to give the value. And so what that called is, to define a custom error, use the content snippet portal generic error. The content snippet is the snippet shown, and okay, I'm just trying to find out what was that content snippet. So there is a content snippet, I think not mentioned the name here, but in that content snippet, if you give the value, that value will be appeared on your portal. So if you have even the liquid, you want to show the big message depending on which user is logged on or something like that, we can customize for the custom error that as well. So this is called the YSOD, yellow screen of death. No developer loves this because definitely you get some error and sometimes not able to understand. And reset a portal. Reset a portal is again about deleting the resources from your portal under definitely certain circumstances. Either you don't want the portal anymore for your environment, or you want to reset and build it from scratch. So in those cases, you will go ahead with the reset a portal. This is again, you go here and click on reset. It will take your, definitely Dynamics will be slow and it takes some time. And every portal action, you see a lot of information is given and self-explanatory. It just, we need to try each option on trial to understand how much time it takes before trying into the production or any other environment directly. So all the portal actions are important at times when it's needed. Actually, when you move your changes from one environment to another, change the base URL of a portal. For example, you had the portal URL as this and you would like to change it to something else. Again, you can just do it. So there is a option to update your portal URL, base URL. You can just give the new URL and it just update, but it should be unique. Let's say you have another portal which is with the same name, it's not gonna take, because when we even provision a portal, it requires the unique name. This is how it changes the base URL. Again, it takes some time to, you know, basically apply that change. And then we have maintenance mode. As I said, basically, sometimes when we are doing deployments, we want to show a particular message and say, like, our website is under maintenance. In that case, no web pages, nothing will be accessible. Only what will be accessible is service about where we actually go to clear the cache. So how to enable the maintenance mode? It's just again here. So here, if we don't give any custom page, you know, it just gives the out of the box, just normal, basically common error. But if you would like to give the proper error with the detailed information why your website is down, you can create a custom web page and give the lot of information. And there you can also have dynamic parameters with the customer name, so that, you know, customer, hi Meenakshi or hi Claire, like, this is the issue, that's why we are not able to provide the service. And it takes the Dynamics parameter because we will be using definitely the web template for that. And this is how it works, and it asks for the custom web page URL as well. So again, web page URL that we see on the top, we can just get that and enable it. And then we can disable once your deployment or whatever the reason we were going for maintenance mode. And the next one after this, add a custom domain name. So a custom domain name can help your customer find the support resources more easily and enhance your brand. You can add when the portal is production state. So for this one, we need the SSL certificate. This option, again, I have not tried, but this there's a possibility to add a custom domain name. So I have given the link here, which you guys can go through if it is required to have a custom domain for your portal. Then portal checker, as we have seen, if we run the portal checker in our current portal, how it shows the errors. So let's just see, it's just a quick one. If we say run portal checker, it gives some in categories. There are multiple categories in which it will show that it is success or failure. In case you have web service call or something like that, it will just say startup issue, performance issue, or the configuration issue. So I think there are just three categories in which it can just give you the more details around whichever gets failed. This is how the portal checker helps. Similarly, we have solution checker and Dynamics. So similarly, it works like that. Clear server side cache. So server side cache has been a big issue in the portals till now, but with the latest versions to clear the cache, we have good option as I have gone through, like, you know, I have multiple sessions. Even though you make a small change, just go with services about and it gives you this screen. Since I have not logged in, if I'm logged in with the admin, you will see an option to clear the cache. So this is how we can clear the cache to reflect our changes as soon as possible. Or we open the portal studio, click on the browse website. In that case, we can directly go to the services about, just click on the browse websites and clear the cache and just show us. So this is how we can clear the server side caching. So as an admin, these are the basically basic tasks, nothing much, but it just until unless we haven't tried on our, you know, before production environment, it can be a risk because these things like resetting an environment is like everything is gone. Similarly, we have like deleting a website. Single record can remove whole of your portal, as we have seen in the first session. So we need to be careful as an admin, or else don't give the admin rights to everyone, just to the main people who has enough information about it, because PowerApps portal is just made up of the records. There is nothing like that we can recover it. It just you need to, I think, if you roll back the environment, it might come back, but I haven't tried that. But definitely, once upon a time, I have deleted the website record and whole project went down. So we need to be careful on that. About the portal life cycle, so definitely when we have a trial PowerApps portal, it comes for 30 days, and then it goes into the suspended state for 7 days, and it keeps on telling that, you know, your portal will be deleted within the 7 days. If you would like, go for the production or just, you know, convert it to production. So this is how the portal life cycle works. So if we just go to the admin center and see here again, if I go to the portal details, you'll be seeing that how many days are left for your this. So your trial portal will expire in 24 days, convert your this. If 30 days are over, still for the 7 days, it will be suspended and you will be allowed to convert it to production. But after 7 days, your portal will be deleted. You won't be able to convert or do anything. This will just be deleted. So you get at least after trial the 7 days for the suspension. So again, trial portal, we know it's the basic one, comes with no cost, and you can do hits and trial and learn how many things you want. Suspended, it just we can, as an admin, you can convert a trial or suspended portal to a production portal. When converting a portal from this to this, you must ensure that environment is also a production environment. Definitely, you can't convert a trial portal to a production portal in a trial environment. That's right. And then deleted portal, once it is deleted, portal is also deleted. We can't convert it to production anymore. One note that is there is the first portal is free to be created in an environment in a tenant. If you need to create more than one portal, you must have 1 GB of unused storage space, because I have noticed this nowadays when I create a trial for the PowerApps, it just comes with no PowerApps. It just when you install particular provision starter portal, you just get the portal management tab. So things are changing with time, because earlier we used to get a lot of apps, but now it's just the blanks one. So convert a portal from trial to production, how to do that? You just get many options because Microsoft wants it that you convert it. So you get like here the convert button and just click on that. You need to pay and do things. And then basically to convert your portal from trial to production, you need to have the proper admin rights. So as an admin for the PowerApps Portal Administration Center, whatever action you do, you need to have correct privileges, plus you just need to have enough experience to perform these actions for your website. And then again, you have another option. So if you go to the portal actions here also, you will see this option to convert. So if I click on portal options, so from here also, you can just convert it to production. That's perfect. Upgrading a portal, we have this option as I explained, I think in the very first go. So if I come down and you see that you can enable this for early upgrade and you can enable your portal for the upgrades. Apart from this, cookies used by portal. So definitely cookies are nothing but these small files and they will be available just on your browser. This is nothing related to the user or something like that. This is machine to machine. So this sometimes helps us in the performance. So definitely we clear the cookies by doing by clearing the server side cache and things, but cookies definitely helps us sometimes in the performance. And I think for the portal administration, this is all that I had today. Nothing much, but yes, as an admin, you can perform all the actions which I have shown. Feedback link is here. It's all cumulatives from all the 5 sessions. So thanks all for joining and do provide the feedback for improving myself for the next maybe series on some other topic. And that's all as a portal admin we can do. Thanks everyone for joining and let's go ahead with the Q&A.
Thanks, Manny.